this is a competition to see who can hold their hand over the candle the longest, who wants to hurt the most, who is willing to find something they maybe never have found before to take an Olympic medal. There you can see how close it is, 56.42 to 56.41 for third to fourth, and then 55.92 points in the fifth position. We started off the competition with, I think, 23 athletes, and we'll wait and see how many actually line up, or 24 athletes on the start line here, because it's tough. Two really long days in extraordinarily hot conditions here, and you know, the six of the seven events are speed and power based, and all of a sudden let's make you run two laps that you're not really built for, and you hate the training and it hurts. None of the other events really hurt to train for, maybe the 200 a bit, but they're the fun events. And then I think this is where it sorts out your character, running the 1500 meters. There's two heats in the women's heptathlon 800 meters, and they'll run those that are the bottom order coming into the event first, and then the others will run in the top heat.
So these are, to some degree, this is a bit of a victory lap for these women, for coming to the Olympics, competing the decathlon. They're probably not in the medals, as we've just kind of run through all that math. But this is really a special moment for them. There's Vanessa Grimm. She comes out here fifth in growth. She's in 19th place right now, but I know a lot of people that haven't been to the Olympics and completed a heptathlon. So what they've done is special. Georgia Ellenwood, first global heptathlon, so I'm sure there's a lot to learn the first time you come out on this stage. Spain, just 20 years old, Maria Vicente, so you know that at some point she'll be a force if she gets back here and stays on the global stage. Aguiar, South American record holder. She sits 16th.
Still some energy left here.
I was going to say, look, there's one that belies what you said. She's not taped up at all, Jane.
And she runs a mean 800 as well. She's got a personal best of 2.7. I'd be surprised if she ran that today.
2.07, yep. Maria Huntington. She's had a really nice little second day out here. She's come through, three-time finish champ. Although 2.22, so you know when you run that this is going to hurt for her. Certainly. Meyer World Championship 2019. She finished third, so she's got better in her, but sometimes it is not your day, or in this case, your 2 days when you come through. Voronina, 2019 Asian Games champion. She sits 12th. And then Niali Zhang, transfer to Allegiance from Canada. She was Kansas State University, but her grandmother was Chinese, and she said she switched allegiances because she wanted to do that and be an Olympian, like her grandmother wanted her to be an Olympian. And she trots out there representing China and representing her grandmother. And I can't think of many things that are better than, you know, representing country and your grandmother. There's a lot of pride when you go stand on that line for her over these next two laps. Don't need to do quite as complicated math as we will in the second heat.
Well, for many of these women, it's really about getting around there and equipping yourself as best as you can with whatever energy you've got left. And those where the 800 meters is a strong event, they'll still want to rack up some points and try and at least, you know, some of them will say, I did a personal best at the Olympic Games. And I think that's enough.
To some extent, I feel like this is where the crowd not being here is missed almost more than in the Olympic moment of the victory, which you expect. But this is where they would get their due. They would get their applause. They would see the appreciation that everybody has for the effort they made.
There will be an enormous amount of butterflies in those stomachs out there on the track right now.
Even though you've run around the track a billion times. Final event of seven for these heptathletes here at the Tokyo 2020 Olympics.
And as expected, it is Xenia Krizan who is going to take the lead at 2.07. Maya's also run a 2.07, so they are the form athletes in this race.
And she was 16 in 2016, so she gets a chance to move up. And your second Olympic Games, you come through, and if you've improved your spot, small victories. There's all kinds of victories to be taken out of these competitions.
And it's Aguilar, the Colombian, sitting in second, and she's run 2:10 before, so they are running to form, which you kind of expect in this race. Krizan, she should go through in low 60s with a 2:07 PBs.
You sit back there in fourth right now from Poland is Sulek, and she's got a world junior bronze, so you know she'll get a chance to grow into this event as well.
And she's really giving it some now. She's going to really take it forward. But I love the fact that Krizan, despite the fact she may not have gone as well in some of the other events, she still wants to maximize her points. And look at Shulak come through, and she wants to take her by the looks of it, running over the back straight. It's a really strong second 200, and Maya coming up to 200 to go. This is where the countdown goes. 190 to go, 180 to go, 170 to go. I've got to get there sooner or later.
It's that bad.
It is.
That we are literally counting it down. Well, fantastic performances for all of these women you see from Austria. Verna Mayer there giving chase as well. Look, she's got a little run in her here. She's going to come strong. Those three across.
Well, they're going to run really well, and they could run personal bests here, which is so brilliant. 2:07 at the end of these 2 days is exceptional for a heptathlete. And there may even be a personal best or two there. Take a bow, heptathletes. You deserve it.
Take a bow or take a seat or
lie down if you really feel you need to.
They're going to have a lie down right here for a minute.
There you go.
A proper lie down.
Oh, they've run to exhaustion. In fact, they've competed to exhaustion over the last 2 days. It's really hard at a major championship. They've warmed up 4 times in this weather, and they have very, very long days.
I understand the physical nature of this. What about just the relief that all of a sudden you've had this focus for 2 days and you get to let that go?
Well, I tell you what, it's more about this, is it doesn't matter how much pain you're in. You're going, that was not as bad as I thought it was going to be. Every time. It's like having a needle almost is the analogy that we use. It's never as bad as you think it's going to be. Well, a wonderful first heat of the women's heptathlon 800 metres. I'm sure there's a few PBs in there, which is seriously hard to do.
Yep, Sulek with a PB. Same with Voronina. Season best for places 1 and 3. Niali Zhang. She comes through with a personal best. Aguiar finished going backwards a little bit, but 2:10.45. All of them produced their best here, even when they were out of the medal contention.
Great running that. You've got the first three inside 2:08, the first five inside 2:10. That is fantastic running at the end of a heptathlon.
And in fact, I think it's the first eight inside 2:11. So, to put it in context, it is different at a major championship like this because it is those very, very long days. It's all the warm-up that happens. So to run personal bests in the last event, let's hope the decathletes can replicate some of that as well. And whilst some of them might look like they are built like 800 metres, believe me, their muscle makeup is not.
And every one of them pushed then over 6,000 points, which is always a barrier to come through. And literally, you know, for the next a couple of minutes, they're leading the heptathlon at the Olympic Games.
Well, until we get to the second heat, of course, because that's where we've got our medalists, and there is going to be an almighty battle for the bronze.
Yes, and there's so little to choose between Kendall Williams and OOsterwegel. It's basically a straight head-to-head with the caveat of Vitz, depending on how fast she runs with that 2:09 PB. Well, if she can get down to 2:07 plus change, like these three, you never know.
Well, believe me, Kendall, who is the slowest of those 800s, will know. And she will be, we have an expression in Australia, I'm not sure whether you guys have it, packing death. She will be as nervous as you can possibly imagine, like a cat on a hot tin roof coming into this. And she is going to have to hang on to Oosterweg and to Witz, because she'll know they'll go out.
Warner has 9,000 points and the gold medal within his grasp, but it's a mark of how hot it still is here in the stadium. He's having to wear an ice vest. It's still boiling here. The air is so heavy with humidity and a growing sense of anticipation. Could it be the crowning moment of his career? It should be.
Is there comfort in knowing that you are 36 seconds ahead of second place, and that frees you up to chase some of these other things?
I think the comfort is in knowing, and I think Ashton Eaton showed this. Actually, it's not about winning the gold medal now. It's about pride. And it's about doing the best you can possibly do, which really, when it comes down to it, that is the only thing you have control of. As we look at the final results there of the heat one of the women's 800 metres for the heptathlon, and we head back down to the track to introduce those that are going to bring us home.
And bring us home with which medals and with which order? It's the heat that will decide gold, silver and bronze in the women's heptathlon after an exhausting 2 days. Hodi Ehuanwanu of Benin, second in the African Games a few years ago. Erica Bougard, fourth in Doha, third in the national champs. She will look to finish with a flourish. She's got a PB of 208. Dardic was a world indoor silver medalist a few years ago. She's lying eighth. Another athlete with a 210 PB. Schaefer, she's been around a while, plenty of experience from the 29-year-old. It's been a good campaign. Can she finish off with a performance close to the podium? Annie Kunz, the best tally in the world this year. It's been a tough 2 days. Noor Witz, she's a 209 performer. If she can run her lifetime best, she could nick a medal. But it's going to need to be fast and brave. Emma OOsterwegel, 1 point separating her and Kendall Williams for the bronze, but they need to be aware of the Belgian who's faster than both of them. Kendall Williams, she has not one hand, but probably her little finger on the bronze medal. It's all on the line, and she is the slowest of the three in contention. Anouk Vetter would need to beat Nafissatou Thiam by 5 seconds to turn silver into gold, and she also needs to have a little look over her shoulder. The defending champion, aiming to become only the second woman to successfully defend this title since Jackie Joyner-Kersee managed it in Barcelona in 92. It is hers for the taking, as long as she finishes within 5 seconds of Vetter and she has a better PB than the Dutch woman, it will be gold again for Nafissatou Thiam.
Well, she's the athlete of the ages, really, isn't she, in this multi-event, the heptathlon. We were disappointed to not have the battle we thought we'd get with Katarina Johnson-Thompson and Thiam. They've really been the two to watch over the last 5 years or so. Thiam has just been outstanding, hasn't she? She's defending her title here, and she was the World Athletics Athlete of the Year in 2017 when she won the World Championship and the European Championship. So she, I think, still will go out hard. She'll know that Vetter may have a chance of catching her if she ran a massive lifetime best, but I'll be interested to see what happens here, whether Kendall is just going to try and sit on OOsterwegel, and will they both try and sit on Witz to ensure that she doesn't get that 4 seconds she needs to kind of jump up to that bronze. But, you know, as we've said, her PB is 7 seconds quicker than Kendall's, so they're going to have to find something they've never found before.
The heptathlon 800 metres. Nafissatou Thiam knows this gold could be hers, and it's Noor Witz who has gone to the front straight away. She's got to make sure this is fast.
Bougard leading, She has the fastest time in the field, but not far behind her is Vitz, and you can see that Williams is trying to sit on Vitz's shoulder. She's, as we said, 7 seconds behind Vitz, and this could hurt her. Vitz needs to stick on Bugard and try and get dragged through to that 208, 209 mark. And Williams, we watch what happens for her with the third 200. That's normally when we see the heptathletes separate those that have a good one from those that don't. And there's Thiam, of course, the event leader, and Vetter is trying to stick on her, and she'll have to try and pass her on the back straight, I think, and get some time out of her.
Bugard leading as they come up to the bell. Vitz has the best PB of the three women vying for the bronze, but remember, she needs to finish 4 or 5 seconds ahead of the women on her shoulder. They take the bell in the heptathlon. Noor Vitz is making a bold, bold bid to get herself on the podium, and look at the speed with which she's pulling away. OOsterwegel senses the danger. She's tracking the Belgian.
Williams has dropped, and now can OOsterwegel stay within 5 seconds of Vitz? 5 seconds is going to be about 30 metres here, and Vitz is getting further and further away with 200 metres to go.
What a way to run yourself onto an Olympic podium. Noor Vitz, the European indoor silver medalist, the teammate of Nafi Thiam, who surely has gold in the bag. Thiam is back in the pack. It doesn't matter about that. Every split second counts here. Look at the way OOsterwegel is desperately trying to accelerate. We'll have to watch the clock really carefully. What a brave, brave bid for bronze from Noor Vitz. Inside 2:10. OOsterwegel, I think, has just done enough to hang on for that third spot on the podium as Nafi Thiam crosses the line. And she now does officially become one of the all-time greats. A world champion, a European champion, is now the double Olympic champion. So talented, so graceful to watch, and so composed under immense pressure. She shares a moment with her teammate there. Noor Vitz did everything she could to try and finish on the podium. I think the Dutch woman has just done enough to deny her the glorious finish.
I think she may have too. It's carnage out there, isn't it, at the end of the track. It's really tough, and OOsterwegel ran magnificently. She's run 2:12, and she knew she had to run up near her best, and we can see now Vitz has run a personal best, and OOsterwegel's run a personal best, and Schaefer's run a season's best, and Dadic has run a season's best. So has Thiam, by the way. So really brilliant running, and tears of joy there for OOsterwegel. Well, I think she may have scored herself a personal best here in the heptathlon too, and I think Vitz has been the find of the competition, and she showed her courage and tenacity with that 800 metre personal best right at the end. Kendall Williams sadly couldn't keep up with them and dropped off after the 400 metres.
And there's the confirmation by 19 points. OOsterwegel has withstood the storming finish of Noor Vitz. That was a brilliant, brilliant effort from both of them. First, for Vitz to really take it out over the last 300 metres. And secondly, for OOsterwegel to somehow just about keep that elastic band from snapping.
Well, it's Belgium, Netherlands, Netherlands, Belgium, the first four in those positions, and Williams will end up finishing fifth. It's interesting when you watch this, because I often think, and I would say this even about the young Australian decathlete, you do have to remember this is a seven-event competition, and you cannot have a weak 800 metres or 1,500 metres when it comes to this level of competitiveness. You just give away too many points.
He's done it. He's climbed to the top of the mountain.
And he's had disappointment too.
Look at the family board.
Nafi Thiam now gets to see the loved ones who really wanted to be in the stadium. It's the next best thing, and what a celebration they'll have when they're all reunited at the end of Tokyo 2020. Thiam cements her place as one of the all-time greats, and she's still young enough to do it all over again. Paris is only 3 years away.
I feel like before you can do another one, you have to forget the last one.
Bit like having children.
Well, that's why maybe you should have them two at a time. So that's been a really neat feature to go and, you know, see the family and your loved ones and all those that have helped pull you to that point and up onto that podium. Because it's not a very high step, but it takes a ton of people to pull you up to the top of it, doesn't it?
Oh, takes a village to make one person. And the dedication that the families of Olympians require is enormous. All those lifts to training at 5 o'clock in the morning, all those late nights, the extra meals, the nutrition, and the anxious wait and worry about whether they're going to recover from injuries.
I was going to say, I think that's the hardest thing for families. It's when an athlete is injured and things are not going well. It's always easy to be with people when they're going well, isn't it? And things are smooth. But these multi-eventers, as I said, they are a bunch of injuries taped together, and they are a lot of up and downs throughout their careers. And Thiam has had them, and she's been the beneficiary of the Olympics being delayed a year as opposed to KJT, who wasn't.
Nuovitz with that personal best, but OOsterwegel crucially stayed within 2 and a bit seconds to hang on to the bronze. It was a fantastic effort from both of them. Nafi Tiam's 2:15.98, more than good enough to confirm her second successive gold. What a fantastic climax to two enthralling days. Nafi Thiam is once again the Olympic champion. Vetter the silver, and OOsterwegel just managing to hold on to Nuovitz and deny the Belgian the bronze. Four athletes not able to make it to the finish line, including the reigning world champion, Katarina Johnson-Thompson. Two combined events athletes have become all-time greats. Nafi Thiam, only the second woman to successfully defend the Olympic heptathlon title, and Damian Warner storms his way to fourth on the all-time list. Finally, he's the champion, and finally, he's joined that elusive club of men with 9,000-plus points to their name. A fantastic evening of decathlon and heptathlon. It's been superb. Well, we had two amazing days of combined events action. Apparently, heptathletes and decathletes prefer people to say combined events, not multi-events. I don't know why. Anyway, a great competition. Mr. Pierre-Olivier Beckers, Belgian IOC member. And he will be delighted. I beg your pardon, Baron Pierre-Olivier Beckers Valjean, to give him his full grand title. He'll be delighted to be making the presentation to the gold medalist especially. Mrs. Sylvia Barlag from the Netherlands, and she too, well, you can tell she's smiling already. World Athletics Council member, the eyes never stop smiling. These masks might be a pain, a necessary pain, but you can still tell when someone's smiling, and she's loving every second of that. And why not? Because she's got two highly decorated compatriots stepping up to the podium. Emma OOsterwegel gave chase to Nuovitz. Vitz put her stall out on the last lap, desperately trying to deny the young Dutchwoman a great bronze medal. It was ever so close between the two of them. OOsterwegel needed to finish within about 4 seconds of the Belgian, who smashed her PB for fourth, so she's had a great games. And she did. She came home in 2:11 in the 800 metres and scored a massive PB, 6,590. She is the Olympic bronze medalist, and boy, oh boy, did she earn it on that 800.
Silver medalist, Netherlands. Anouk Vetter.
And a little bit further back down the 800 course with 2:18, her compatriot Anouk Vetter was storming her way to a magnificent silver and a magnificent national record. 6,689 points. A marvellous moment for the two Dutch women, continuing their fine history of heptathletes. Remember, Daphne Schippers, the double world champion over 200 metres, started out as a heptathlete and I think got a bronze in Moscow in the Worlds. And neither of them will mind one little bit at who beat them, because this young woman is fast becoming one of the all-time greats. Nafissatou Thiam of Belgium becomes only the second woman to successfully defend the pentathlon stroke heptathlon title, as it's known now. If you were being really cynical, you might say, well, we were denied the duel with the reigning world champion Katarina Johnson-Thompson. But this was a performance of such dominance, I'm not sure the Briton would have been able to live with her. She was simply magnificent, Thiam. And she's had her tough times bouncing back from injuries. She's had problems with her elbow in the past. But she is now the double Olympic champion. And who would bet against her making it a hat-trick in 3 years' time? She's that good. She's unbelievably close to her mum and grateful for all that she did for her when she was growing up. And although her mother, of course, and none of these athletes are allowed to have their close relatives here unless they're specifically officially involved as coaches, far away, Mrs. Thiam will be watching and waiting to give her daughter the biggest hug in the world. And hopefully she'll have the medal round her neck when she walks back in the front door. Two golds for Nafi Thiam. An unbelievable talent who always delivers her very best, even when the pressure is on.
Have had a fabulous meet between the work of Femke Bol and here with the heptathletes. I earlier in the games covered 3x3 basketball, and the Orange Lions showed themselves to be excellent competition in that first ever Olympic event.